Hello everyone. So welcome to the six days webinar on operating system bootcamp organized by Access. Hope you guys have enjoyed yesterday's session. And there is one announcement for all of you. As there is vast syllabus, so we have decided that we will take a full webinar, and there will be no doubt solving, and we will give you a Google Forms for the doubt solving, and we will give you a solution as well as the useful links for that. Okay, so let us start the section. So today we are going to focus more on operating system, in which we are going to see CPU scheduling. So the topics which we are going to cover in this today's session are introduction to the CPU scheduling and process, preemptive and non-preemptive scheduling, FCFS scheduling, that is first come first served scheduling, SJF scheduling, that is shortage of first scheduling, round robin, priority scheduling, and lottery process scheduling. So we will start from the basic concept. What is process? So process is basically a program in execution. You all have written many programs in CPP. So the execution of program takes place line by line. So the execution of process must progress in a sequential fashion. Every process when running in the background go through different states. So we are going to see the states of the progress. Here, when suppose you have started any musical app, so a new process is started, so it goes into this new state. After when there is a space empty, then this process goes into this ready queue. After that, when it gets this processor to execution, then it goes from ready state to the running state. And after when the process is executed, it gets terminated. Meanwhile, every process has one input time and output time, and also CPU time. So a process want to take input or give output to the user, then it goes into the waiting state. And when this time is over, it goes into the ready queue again. So this is how a process execution takes place. After that, we will see why scheduling is important. So as we have seen, every process includes both IO time and CPU time. But in multi-programming system, only one process is allowed to take place at one time. So when one process has to take input output from user, CPU is free at that time. So their CPU is wasted, and therefore, there is much time wastage in this uniprogramming system. But in multiprogramming system, one process can use CPU while another is waiting for IO. Means what? If one process is wanting to take input from user, then another process can use CPU resources at that time. So we will see now preemptive and non-preemptive scheduling. Before that, we will see what is preemptive process and non-preemptive process. A non-preemptive process is the process which can never be stopped. Once it is started, it executes till the end. It cannot be paused. And the preemptive process is the process which can be paused at any time, unless or until other processes are there in the queue. After that, we are going to see different types of schedulers. But what are the schedulers? These are the special system softwares which handle process scheduling in various ways. Means what? They try to distribute all of the processes which are there in the multi-programming operating system. So there are three types of schedulers: long-term scheduler, short-term scheduler, and mid-term scheduler. So we will see all of this based on this diagram. So what long-term scheduler do? When the process is in new state, it transfers the process from new state to the ready queue. But what short-term scheduler do? When process is in the ready queue, it transfers it to the running queue. And what mid-term scheduler do? It transfers the running process in the waiting state and waiting state process in the ready state. So all these states, as we have all seen, I hope you have understand that. So we will see the basic terminologies which are helpful in solving the various numericals based on CPU scheduling. So first is arrival time, the time required for the process to arrive in the ready state, that means in the main memory. After that, it is burst time, time required for process to execute. And after that, it is completion time, time when process is completed. After that, it is turnaround time, it is difference between completion time and arrival time. After that, it is waiting time, difference between turnaround time and burst time. After that, it is response time, it is difference between first response and arrival time. After that, we are going to see our first algorithm, that is FCFS, first come first served scheduling. So it is very simple algorithm which tells us if one process is arrived at first, it execute till the end. What is here written is run until done, means if it is if it has started execution, it runs till the end. In the beginning, it means that one program runs non-preemptively until it is finished, means without any pause, it runs till the end. For example, we will see one example. Here, three processes arrive in order P1, P2, and P3. The P1 has burst time 24, P2 has burst time of 3, P3 has burst time of 3 seconds. So burst time means execution time, means time for the completion of the process, as we have seen it earlier. So we will see how to solve this problem. So before solving the this problem, it is important to draw this chart. So as we have seen, P1 process comes earlier than P2 and P3, but all three processes are come at the same time, zero time. So P1 has come earlier, it starts processing at 0 seconds. And as it has the burst time of 24 seconds, it executes till the 24 second and completes its execution. After that, P2 process starts its execution at 24th second. And it has burst time of 3 seconds, so it completes its execution at 27th second. After that, P3 has come. So P3 gets the CPU at 27th second, and as it has execution time of 3 seconds, so 27 plus 3, 30 seconds. So P3 completes its execution at 30th second. So here, waiting time, how we calculate waiting time? So here is the formula: waiting time equal to completion time minus arrival time minus burst time. So as P1 has a completion time of 24, as here we can see, it has started at 0th second and completed its execution at 24th second. So as here we can see, it has started at 0th second and completed at 24th second. So it has the completion time of 24 second and waiting time for calculating waiting time,
completion time minus arrival time minus burst time, it is the formula. So arrival time is 0 second, or as all the three processes as has arrived at 0 second, and burst time for first process P1 is 24 seconds. So 24 minus 0 minus 24 equal to 0. So waiting time for process P1 is 0. Again, then P2 process is arrived. So P2 process is arrived at 0 second, but it gets CPU at 24 second. So waiting time for P2 can be calculated as 27 minus 0, which is the arrival time, minus 3. The waiting time for process P2 is 24 seconds. After that, P3. The P3 process is also arrived at 0 second, but it gets CPU at 27 second. So 30 minus 0 minus 3 equal to 27. So average waiting time for each process can be calculated by summing all the waiting times divided by total number of processes. So 0 plus 24 plus 27 divided by 3 equal to 17 is the average waiting time. After that, average completion time. As we can see, P1 is completed at 24 seconds, P2 is completed at 27 seconds, and P3 is completed at 30 seconds. So we can calculate the average completion time as follows. So average completion time is 27 seconds. So here there are some advantages and disadvantages of first come first serve algorithm. The advantage is it is simple algorithm to execute, but the disadvantage is that if long processes are come first and short processes are come late, then long processes take too much time for the execution and short processes get stuck behind those long processes. So, and also performance is highly dependent on the order in which job arrives. As we have seen here, if long processes come earlier, then they take a long time for execution, and hence the waiting time for the short jobs is increased. So performance is dependent on order. So here we go to the second algorithm, which is shortest job first algorithm, or it is known as shortest time to completion first. So it tells us that run whatever job has least amount of computation to do. Means if several processes are arrived, then the process which has less time of execution will be executed first, or will get CPU for the execution. So we will see this by solving one example. Suppose all processes arrive at the same time, which is zero time. So process P1, P2, P3 and P4 arrive at zero time, which having a burst time at 6, 8, 7 and 3. So let us draw a chart. So here, as we have seen, all these four processes arrive at same time zero. But we are watching here that the burst time of all these processes, but P4 process have the execution time lesser than all remaining processes. So P4 process get the CPU first. So P4 starts its execution at the 0th second and completes its execution at 3 seconds. After that, remaining processes P1, P2 and P3, the lesser time, P1 has the lesser time than P2 and P3. So P1 gets the CPU. So P1 starts its execution at 3rd second, and as it has execution time of 6 seconds, 3 plus 6, 9. So P1 ends its execution at 9th second. After that, P2 and P3 P3 has the shorter time of execution. So P3 starts its execution at 9th second and completes its execution at 16th second. And after that, the longest process, which having execution time of 8 seconds, starts execution at 16th second and completes its execution at 24th second. So we can calculate average waiting time by the formula we have seen: completion time minus arrival time minus birth time as 0 plus 3 plus 9 plus 16 divided by 4. The 4 are total processes. So average waiting time is 7.0 milliseconds. After that, shortest remaining time to completion first. This algorithm, shortest job first, shortage of first is for the processes which are non-preemptive, which cannot be paused at any time. But the processes which can be paused at any time and go in the waiting state, so for them, this algorithm is there, shortest remaining time to completion first. So it is here written that preemptive version of SJF. If a process arrives and it has shorter time to completion than the remaining time of current job, immediately it preempts the CPU. Means what? If many processes are there and if one process is executing and if new process arrives which has shorter execution time, then CPU is allocated to the newly come process because it has shorter execution time. So we will see this by solving one example. So here four processes have arrived: P1, P2, P3 and P4. The arrival time is 0, 1, 2, 3 and the execution time, that is burst time, is 8, 4, 7 and 5. So P1 has arrived at 0, it starts its execution. When it reaches 1 second, P2 has arrived, which has less time of execution than this P1. So P1 gets preempted and P2 gets CPU. So P2 starts execution at 1st second and matlab 1 second and completes its execution till the end. So P2 starts its execution at 1 second and completes its execution at 5th second. After that, all P3 and P4 are added to the queue, which having execution time 9 and 5. As we are seeing here, P4 has less execution time than P3. So P4 gets the CPU. So P4 starts execution at 5th second and ends at the 10th second. After that, as we have seen, P1 has started processing at 0th second and completed till 1 second. So total time of execution remaining for P1 is 7 seconds. So P1 gets the CPU as it has execution time less than this P3 process. So P1 gets the CPU at 10th second and it completes its execution at 17th second. And after that, the last process, P3, starts its execution at 17th second and completes its execution at 26th second. So here we can see calculation of waiting time formula equal to completion time minus arrival time minus birth time. So here P1 has completed its execution at 17th second. So here we can calculate the waiting time as follows. P1 completes its execution at 17th second, arrives at the 0th second and burst time is 8 seconds. So waiting time for process P1 is 9 seconds. Also P2 process completes its execution at 5th second and arrives at 1 second and burst time is 4 seconds. So waiting time for P2 process is 0. After that, P3 process completes its execution at 26th second. It has arrival time of 2 seconds and burst time of 9 seconds. So
The waiting time for process P3 is 15 seconds. After that, the P4 process completes its execution at 10 seconds and it has arrival time of 3 seconds and burst time of 5 seconds. So it completes, it has waiting time of 2 seconds. So total waiting time of all four processes is 26. So average waiting time is 26 divided by number of processes, which is 4, which is 6.5 milliseconds. So in this way, this problem is solved. After that, we will see advantages of shortest job first algorithm. So shortage of first algorithm gives maximum throughput. So as we are seeing, the CPU is used efficiently, so it gives maximum throughput. After that, minimum average waiting time and turnaround time. As short jobs are done efficiently, so there is minimum waiting time for the other processes. The disadvantages of shortage of first algorithm is may suffer with the problem of starvation. If suppose all processes are arrived and all shorter processes are at the first and longer processes are at the end, then all shorter processes will get executed. Longer processes will not get the CPU. So longer processes suffer the problem of starvation. After that, it is not implementable because exact burst time for the process can't be known in the advance. Means what? We don't know exact the execution time of all processes. So this type of algorithm is not implementable. Third algorithm is round robin scheduling. So what round robin scheduling algorithm says that each process gets a small unit of CPU time. That CPU time is known as time quantum. Means if several processes are there, each process executes for specific amount of time. So this time is known as time quantum. Usually this is 10 to 100 milliseconds. After time quantum expires, the process is preempted and added to the end of the ready queue. Means if the time quantum of 4 seconds, then process executes for the 4 seconds and then it is added to the end of the ready queue. In this way, round robin scheduling is there. We will see one example. Here, example of round robin with time quantum of 4. Here, process P1, P2, P3 arrive at 0 second. And burst time is 24 seconds, 3 seconds, and 3 seconds. So we draw chart is as follows. As all processes come at 0 second, first P1 gets the CPU. So P1 start execution at 0 second. And after that, when time quantum of 4 second is expired, it is added to the ready queue. And after that, P2 process gets the CPU resources. As we are seeing here, the execution time of P2 process is lesser than the time quantum here. So P2 completes its execution, total execution. So as P2 gets the CPU at 4 seconds, so it completes its execution at 7 seconds. After that, P3 process starts its execution at 7 seconds and completes its execution at 10 seconds. As it has completion execution time of 3 seconds. After that, here P1 processes which has started and added to the ready queue, it has execution time remaining of 20 seconds. So P1 process is completed after that from 10 to 30 seconds in time quantum of 4. So here by this chart, we can calculate waiting time and completion time of this problem. So advantages of round robin scheduling is that it is better for short job, as short jobs are completed earlier without more switching between the processes. It is better for the short jobs. After that, disadvantages of the round robin are as follows. Context switching time adds up for the long jobs. So when there is a long job, when two processes switch between each other, there is time required from them for the switching. So this is known as context switching time. So for the long processes, as they switch between each other, there is a time required, and this time because of lot many switching, time is increased. After that, previous example assumed no additional time was needed for context switching. As we have seen in other algorithms, there was no context switching time. But in this type of algorithm, we add to wait and completion time without exactly knowing progressing a process towards the completion. Here, as we are adding the context switching time, the performance is a little bit lowered. After that, priority scheduling. So what priority scheduling means, a priority number is associated with each process. What is a priority number? If a number is lesser, the priority is highest. If a process has one number associated with it, then it has the highest priority. The CPU is allocated to the process with highest priority. So here it is written that smallest integer, then it is highest priority. If preemptive processes are there, if higher priority process enters, then it receives CPU immediately. And if non-preemptive processes are there and a process has higher priority, then it must wait until other processes, which means currently executing processes, finish. So we will see one example and learn this priority scheduling. So here P1, P2, P3, and P4 and P5, these five processes arrive at the same time, that is 0 second, and these have burst time and priority associated with them. Here burst time of P1 is 10 second. Burst time means execution time and priority associated with it. So as all the processes have arrived at 0 second, so we can see here, P2 process has priority highest because it has lower number, 1. So P2 process get CPU at first. So P2 starts execution at 0 second. And as it has the execution time of 1 second, it completes its execution at 1 second. After that, here we can see, process P5 has the priority of 2, means highest priority. So P5 gets the CPU and it starts execution at 1 second and ends at the 6 second. After that, P1 has priority 3. So it is highest among P4 and P3. So P1 gets the CPU and it starts its execution at 6 second. And after that, it completes its execution at 16th second. It has execution time of 10 seconds. After, between P3 and P4, priority of P3 is maximum. So P3 gets the CPU and it starts execution at 16th second. As the execution time of P3 is 2 seconds, it completes its execution at 16 plus 2, 18th second. After the last least priority process, P4 gets CPU and it starts its execution at 18th second and completes its execution at 19th second. From this chart, we can calculate waiting time and completion time. So in this way, the round robin priority scheduling is there. After that, last algorithm is of lottery scheduling. So what is lottery scheduling? Each job is given some lottery tickets. So how to assign the tickets? To approximate the SRTF, that is shortest remaining time first, short running jobs get more tickets and long running job gets fewer tickets. And second is to avoid starvation, that is long waiting. Every job gets at least one ticket. To avoid starvation, every job gets at least one ticket so that everyone gets the CPU. So we will see the example.
Here, the example of lottery scheduling. Suppose short jobs get 10 tickets and long job get 1 ticket. So it is simple mathematics. If one short job is there and one long job is there, so total number of tickets are 11. So percentage of CPU for the short job is 10 divided by 11 multiplied by 100. And the percentage of CPU for each long job is 1 divided by 11 multiplied by 100. It is simple mathematics. So we can calculate all this percentage of short job and long job by the simple mathematics. So we will revise all the algorithms. So from the first come first serve means the process which come first, it is executed until the end, in which all the processes are done based on the order in which they come. After that, we have seen the example. And after that, shortest job first, the job which has shorter time, it gets executed first. After that, shortest remaining time to completion. It is primitive version of shortest job first. If a job arrives and it has shorter time to completion than the remaining time on the current job, CPU is allocated to the newly arrived process. After that, we have seen round robin scheduling. After that, it is round robin scheduling, in which every process gets a fixed amount of CPU time for the execution. It is usually between 10 to 100 milliseconds. And when time quantum expires, the process is primitive and added to the end of the ready queue. After that, priority scheduling. So we have seen that a priority number is associated with each process, and CPU is allocated to the process with highest priority. And after that, lottery scheduling. Lottery scheduling is quite similar to the priority scheduling, but here every job gets at least one ticket, though it is short, though it is long. So for these algorithms, it is important to solve all the numericals. And in interview, they may ask you for solving the questions or the numericals based on these algorithms, or may ask this algorithm and advantages and disadvantages of the algorithms. So all the algorithms are completed. So I will show you all the slides. So tell me if any topic is hard to understand. I will explain it again in the chat box. Don't feel shy to message. If any problem, we will discuss it here again. So, okay, I will explain priority scheduling and round robin scheduling again. So, here, round robin scheduling means what? It is not like that if one process is arrived, it is executed till the end. Every process should get CPU. For that, it is done that time quantum is fixed of any time. So each process get a small unit of CPU time so that each process get chance for the execution. So, and when the time quantum expires, the process is preempted. Means what? Process is paused at that moment and added to the end of the ready queue. And the chance is given to the next process. So we will see one example here. Process P1, P2, P3 arrive at same time 0, but they have different execution time 24, 3 and 3. And the fixed time quantum is 4. Time quantum is decided at the starting by the processor. So here, when P1 process is come first and in the order, so P1 gets the CPU at 0th second, and as the time quantum is 4, it get executed for the 4 seconds only, and it gets preempted and added to the last of the ready queue. So here we can see, as it is executed for 4 seconds only, the time remaining is 20 seconds. So after that, P2 process is there. It is come second in the order. So P2 process gets the CPU. As we can see here, 3 seconds is the execution time for the P2, but time quantum is of 4 seconds. Means what? The execution time of P2 process is less than the time quantum. So it gets executed at 4 seconds and ends completely its execution at 7 seconds. So P2 process has ended up its execution. So it is removed from the queue. After that, P3 process. P3 process has also the execution time lesser than the time quantum. So P3 process gets a processor at 7th second, and it completes its execution at 10th second. So it has completed its execution. So it is finished. That is, it is terminated. So here you can see only P1 process has remained. So P1 process gets CPU at the 10th second and it goes till the last and completes its total execution. So P1 process is also terminated. In this way, round robin scheduling is there. After that, I will explain you priority scheduling. In the priority scheduling, a fixed number is given at the starting of the processes when processes arrive. As the priority number is associated at the starting of each process, CPU is allocated to the process with the highest priority. Means if the process is associated with the smaller number, then it has the highest priority. So there is different case in preemptive processes and non-preemptive processes. If process is preemptive, means it can be paused at any moment and switched to the second process. If a new process which has a greater priority than the currently executing process, then there is switching and CPU is allocated to that process. But in case of non-preemptive scheduling, what happens is that if currently executing process as it is, it is not stoppable. So when a highly priority process come, it must wait until the current process finish. So we will see numerical. Here, P1, P2, P3, P4, P5. These all processes have priority allocated at the beginning. So, and these all processes come at 0th second. So, as you are seeing here, the P2 process has one priority, means it has the highest priority. Recall the statement that if smaller the priority number, highest is the priority. So P2 process get the CPU. P2 starts its execution at 0th second and end at 1 second because it has execution time of 1 second. So P2 is terminated. After that, you can see P5 process has the second highest priority. So P5 process get the CPU here. And it starts execution at 1 second and ends its execution at 6 second because it has the total execution time of 5 second. So P5 process completes its execution and gets terminated. After that, in the remaining process P1, P3 and P4, P1 process has the highest priority. So P1 process gets the CPU and it starts its execution at 6th second. And as it has the burst time of 10 seconds, 6 plus 10, 16. So it ends at its execution at 16th second and gets terminated. After that, two processes are remaining, P3 and P4. The priority of P3 is higher than P4. It is here 4 number and 5 number. As smaller number, it has the highest priority. So P3 process gets the CPU at 16 second and it completes its execution at 18 second. Means it has 2 seconds of execution time. So P3 process completes its execution and gets terminated. And as you are seeing, P4 process having the least priority gets executed at the end. It has the execution time of 1 second. So it gets the CPU at 18th second and gets terminated at 19th second. So in this way, all processes are executed. See, the there is confusion of time quantum. See, the time quantum is decided by the operating system and it is not fixed. It is different for different processes.
If there is any confusion, you can message. See, Vishal has raised one question that how the system is able to compute the completion time required for process before its execution. See, this is used in only one algorithm, that is shortage of first algorithm. So this is not practically used algorithm. Other algorithms are used. So in we can see in priority scheduling, if there is no burst time given, so still we can implement that algorithm. But in the shortage of first algorithm, if burst time is not given, we will not be able to solve the that question. But in other algorithms, we can solve the question if there is no burst time given. You can ask questions if you have. See, I will clear your doubt. Here, see, first come, first served scheduling. Here, process has given P1 process, P2 process, and P3 process all have given the burst time. But if the processes have not given all this completion time or total execution time, still we can implement this this algorithm, because as we all know, P1 process, P2 process, and P3 process order, or the order in which they are arrived. P1 process can have burst time of any time. It is not fixed. So P1 process can complete still, the burst time is not known. P2 process can still be executed if the completion time is not known. P3 process also. In the shortage of first scheduling, what we have to see is that which process has the shortest time. So it is not implementable because we don't know the execution time at the first. So this only algorithm is not implementable. But in other algorithms, if the burst time is not given, still we can implement that algorithms because burst time is not needed. Here you can see only time quantum is required and the arrival time. If burst time is not given, still we can manage the processes. Is the doubt is clear? So if any doubt, you can message, or otherwise we can end this session.
Just message if there is no doubt. So thank you all of you for attending this session, and this was all about the CPU scheduling session. I hope you liked the session. So our team will meet you soon with the amazing sessions in next few video series. So enjoy learning, stay safe. Thank you.